Sunday Pentecost comes to us from the Gospel according to St. Luke, reading from the 7th chapter, beginning with the 36th verse.
Glory to you, O Lord.
One of the Pharisees invited Jesus to eat with him. Jesus went to the Pharisee's house and was eating at the table. A woman who had lived a sinful life in that city found out that Jesus was eating at the Pharisee's house. So she took a bottle of perfume and knelt at his feet. She was crying and washed his feet with her tears. Then she dried his feet with her hair, kissed them over and over again, and poured the perfume on them. The Pharisee who had invited Jesus saw this and thought, this man really were a prophet. He would know what sort of woman is touching him. She's a sinner. Jesus spoke up. Simon, I have something to say to you. Simon replied, teacher, you're free to speak. So Jesus said, two men owed money lenders some money. One owed him 500 silver coins and the other owed him 50. When they couldn't pay it back, he was kind enough to cancel their debts. Now, who do you think will love him the most? Simon answered, I suppose the one with the largest debt canceled him. Jesus said to him, you're right. And turning to the woman, he said to Simon, you see this woman, don't you? I came to your house. You didn't wash my feet. But she has washed my feet with her tears and dried them with her hair. You didn't give me a kiss. But ever since I came in, she has not stopped kissing my feet. You didn't put any olive oil on my head. But she has poured perfume on my feet. That's why I'm telling you, their many sins have been forgiven. Her great love proves that. But whoever receives little forgiveness loves very little. And Jesus said to her, your sins have been forgiven. The other guests thought, who is this man who even forgives sins? Jesus said to the woman, your faith has saved you. Go in peace. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Grace be unto you and peace from God, our Heavenly Father, and from our Lord and our Savior, Jesus Christ. Many of you will remember that I served as a resident assistant in the dormitory that I was in college. And that was an important time in my life, a memorable one, one from which many stories could be told. But I want to share the story of a couple of people this morning. One is a woman named Suzy. When she first came to the dormitory, she was the life of the party. She was the center of attention. She was a very pretty girl, very gregarious, very friendly, and was participating in every social sort of activity that there was, and was really well liked at first by everyone. But it got to the point that she participated in so many parties and so many things, she was known as a bit of a party animal. And from there, her reputation went downhill. Indeed, she began to be known by all of the young women on their floors in the dormitory as someone they didn't want to be around at all. And by some of the more opportunistic young men as somebody they really wanted at their parties because she was going to be fun. Suzy had a bad reputation. There was another person I'm going to tell you about as well. His name was Clifford. Clifford was an interesting person, but in the same way that one could say of Suzy, whenever there was a party, the one thing you could be sure of is that Suzy would be there. You could also say that whenever there was a party, the one thing you could be sure of was that Clifford wouldn't be. Clifford was a recluse. He didn't really talk to anybody at all, although I had spoken to him from time to time because I was his RA and didn't have a choice. He was a nice fellow, but just didn't need the kind of social interaction that most people do. He was quite content to be by himself, stayed in his room most of the time, and basically did everything alone, without evidently being lonely. He seemed quite content. Odd, but content. One day I remember seeing Clifford in the cafeteria. I had come back late from a noontime class, and it was not odd for me to come in there. It wasn't odd for me to see Clifford either, because I came in, I had this noontime class, and by the time that I got there for lunch, most of the cafeteria had cleared out, and I would always see Clifford off all by himself eating his lunch. But this time was different. For I could see Clifford, and in front of him, he was talking to somebody. Now that, in the first place, was very unusual. But what was even more unusual is that Clifford was talking to a girl. And I thought, oh, Clifford, that was interesting. And I didn't see who it was, and I went and I got my food, and it took a few minutes, because you see, in college, I was terribly spoiled. There was a lady there who was our head cook. Her name was Elizabeth, and everybody called her Mama, and Mama spoiled me. You see, when I didn't like something, Mama would make me an omelet. So Mama was preparing my omelet, and I got my food, and I came out. And when I came out, and as I walked through towards the table where I was going to sit, I looked over to the side, and I could see that Clifford was having this wonderful conversation with Suzy. And two things crossed my mind at that time. First was, this is so cute, that this girl, Suzy, who, though she had a bad reputation, I could see in her eyes when I saw her that she truly was lonely. She truly was sad somehow. And I was happy for her that she was having this conversation that gave her some joy with a person that I knew to be a decent person. And on the other hand, I was delighted for Clifford that he was pretending to be human for a change. But the other part of me too was, I was thinking, does Clifford actually know who he's talking to here? Part of me was protective towards him because I thought, Clifford, I don't know if you know what you're doing. But anyway, it's fine. And in the coming days, they were seen together more and more frequently. They would be seen at lunch, they would be seen at dinner, even walking down the hallways together. It became clear to everyone after a fairly short period of time that these two were an item. This is all good. But as you may know, that the nature of humanity is that when we start with something, when we begin to gossip about something, we can't stop ourselves. And the reputation that Suzy had so diligently worked on for so long had stuck with her. There were still murmurs and titters and giggles every time she walked by because she had become, for some, a bit of a laughing stock. And Suzy continued to suffer at the hands of the people who would ridicule her. And one time, Clifford came to see me. This was the only time that Clifford ever came to see me. And when he came to see me, it was to talk about Suzy. Clifford was beside himself in anger. He was furious because this young woman, whom he had come to know and genuinely have affection for, was being hurt terribly by him. And at first I thought, well, maybe Clifford, you don't really know the whole story here. But as he continued to talk and he just let it all out, it was clear that he knew everything. He, first of all, had heard all of the terrible things that had been said about her, but also he had heard from her everything that she had done. He had heard from her everything that she had done, and yet he chose to remain with her because he also knew that this young woman was remorseful and living in considerable pain, not only because of the way people were treating her, but because of what she herself had done. And I remember in that moment in time, I was so terribly impressed with Clifford because he had done the one thing that an entire dormitory full of good Christian people, this was a Christian dormitory, he had done the one thing that an entire dormitory full of Christian people did not and could not do. He forgave her and showed her love and compassion that apparently the rest of us were incapable of. Clifford, without even probably knowing what he was doing, was in some measure behaving a lot like Jesus then. In our text today, we hear a story of how Jesus dealt with that kind of judgment. He'd been invited to dinner. And it probably wasn't a friend inviting him to dinner, but somebody who was inviting all of the important people in town. And Jesus, if nothing else, was pretty important because everybody knew who he was, and he was a topic of conversation, and he was always around. And so Simon, when he invited all of these other important guests to his dinner, also invited Jesus. Now, as it turns out, this woman, who had a reputation in that town, living a tough life, she heard that Jesus was going to this place as well. So she went too, undoubtedly uninvited. But she went because she had the intention of seeing Jesus, because she, in her own mind, felt pain and sorrow and sadness over the way things in her life had gone. And so she went there and she found Jesus and she sat at his feet, and you heard the text. With her tears, she washed his feet, and with her hair, she dried his feet and kissed them over and over and over again. Now, in our day and age, that just sounds awfully strange because we don't get that kind of custom. But in those days, there's a couple things that you need to know. First of all, when you went into a guest in someone's house, the way that people would greet you was with an embrace and a kiss. There was nothing inappropriate about that. With an embrace and a kiss, and that was just what you did. In the same way that today, perhaps, we shake someone's hand, in those days, it was with a kiss of fellowship with which people were greeted. And additionally, because of the way in which the people lived, with terribly dusty roads and very dry conditions, when a guest would come over, it would be not uncommon for them to be offered a basin of water with a towel and perhaps a servant to wash their feet, because you would come in off the road very dusty. And it was a sign of common courtesy to allow someone to wash their feet, just in the same way that we today would allow someone who's just coming off the road an opportunity to freshen up before dinner, or whatever the case may be. So these kinds of things, though they sound strange to us, they're not strange at all. Now Simon, when he saw what the woman was doing, paying this kind of inordinate attention to Jesus, he thought to himself, "Oh, if this guy really were a prophet, he'd know what kind of woman she is." And Jesus said, "Simon, there's something I want to say to you. Go ahead, Master, you're free to speak." And he proceeded to tell the story. He said, "Simon, there were two people that owed a money lender, a fair bit of money. One owed 500 silver pieces, the other owed 50. And the money lender decided to cancel the debt of both of them. Now, which of them do you suppose loved him the most?" Simon said, "I imagine the one whose debt was the greater would love him the most." And Jesus said, "You're right. Simon, do you see this woman here? She has, without stopping, in her tears and with her tears, washed my feet. And she's dried my feet with her hair, and she's continued to kiss my feet. When I came into your house, Simon, you didn't kiss me. You didn't greet me. When I came into your house, Simon, you never offered me anything with which to wash my feet, but this woman hasn't stopped. She has, by her act of love, shown me how sorrowful she is for what it is that she's done. She's shown me something important here, none of which, Simon, you've shown. For the person for whom much has been forgiven, there will be much love." And so Jesus turned to the woman and said, "Your sins are forgiven you. Woman left. Her life somehow changed because someone saw that she needed to be loved and she needed to be forgiven. But Simon, who, as it turns out, was a Pharisee, whose focus was absolutely on doing the right thing, because he knew what the right thing was. It was the thing that had been predetermined by his community. All he had for her was judgment. Brothers and sisters in Christ, on this day, I want to invite you into a life that would be more like that of Jesus. And if you can't manage that, even maybe more like that of Clifford. A life of compassion and forgiveness for someone who needs it. For if we offer in that moment in time love and compassion and forgiveness to someone who needs it, we can change their lives. But far too often we behave more like a Pharisee. We sit in judgment of one another. Especially if someone ever comes into a context that is our normal, our regular kind of situation. We don't want that kind of person here. We don't want the kind of person who's a sinner in here. And the one place that a sinner absolutely doesn't want to go into is in with a group of self-righteous Christians, because when they do that, what they will find there is not love and compassion and forgiveness, but they will find judgment. Brothers and sisters, the business that we're in here is not that. We're not here to judge. We're here to share the forgiveness that God has shown to us. We're here to share the forgiveness that God has won for us in Christ Jesus. Now, we do this for two reasons. We do it because we're sinners. Even those of us who are big shots, highfalutin, important people, who know our tradition, who have been with it forever, we are sinners. But we're really, really good at hiding it. Did you hear the text from Samuel that Sarah shared with us this morning? It's the story of one of my favorites, not in a good sense, but one of my favorite stories from the Old Testament, because it's the story of King David and his activities with Bathsheba. King David had been, as a young man, you know, David slew Goliath and all that, and then he was anointed king, and he spent a good part of his life trying to escape Saul, who was the king and who was trying to kill him. David had gone through a lot of difficulty and had been helped at almost every point by the Lord, but David could not help himself or restrain himself when he needed to. King David, he was already in the palace, and one day he was on the roof of his palace, which, because of the construction in that area, it was a flat-roofed house. He was looking out over the city, and down beneath him was a smaller house, the house of Uriah, the Hittite, and his wife Bathsheba. And Bathsheba was on the roof of the house bathing, because that was the most private place you could be in a way. Most people would imagine somebody above them looking down at them. But there he was, staring at her, deciding that he wanted her. And in our text, not the text that she read, but the text tells us that it's very likely he forced himself on her. He was the king, and when the king asks you to come over and be with him, there's very little a woman can do. King David, with all due respect. Now he thought he got away with this. He'd taken her, he set up a story, he worked it out, he knew what he was doing, he had everything fixed. It was a secret. So Nathan came and told him the story. He said, King David, we have a problem in the kingdom. There was a rich man and a poor man, and the rich man had everything he wanted. Flocks coming out of his ears, everything. The poor man lived beside him, and all he had was this small little ewe lamb. So endeared to the family was, it was almost like a daughter. He held it and carried it and fed it by hand off his own plate. This was his baby. Well, one day the rich man had a visitor come, and he knew that he had to prepare for him a little bit of a feast, but he didn't think that, oh, I don't want to go to all the trouble of going out in the field and getting one of my own. I will just take the next door neighbor's, because so he took his ewe lamb and slaughtered it so he might have a feast for his visitor. And he was good. pay back at least four times what he's taken. Because he did it without heart, without compassion, with nothing. And Nathan said, "You're the man who's taken from someone who has nothing." Brothers and sisters, in the context of the community of God, we too can be blind to what it is that we've done, who it is that we are. But I'm here to tell you that we are sinners. All of us. There's not one of us who is not. So in this regard, we are not better than the woman in our text today. We are not better than Suzy. We are not better than anyone. All of us are sinners. And all of us, brothers and sisters, are children of God, people for whom Jesus died. All of us are people for whom Jesus died because he loves us, including Suzy, including the woman in the text, including Bathsheba, Uriah, and David. The whole lot of us are sinners for whom Jesus died, and to whom has been given the gift of forgiveness. So when you have an opportunity, it is my prayer for you this day that when someone comes into your life, perhaps into your church, in the pew beside you, who you know to be a sinner, who you know to be born burdened down with the weight of all that they've done, I want you to consider this. Your first reaction, despite your knowledge or lack thereof, should not be judgment. It should be forgiveness. Your first reaction should not be to condemn, but to embrace. Your first reaction should not be to chase away, but to gather in. Because this act of love and this sort of love is exactly what Jesus has done for us. So as you leave this place today, consider what Jesus has done for you. You are here, forgiven and loved, because that's what Jesus did for you. And you are here now, called upon to behave in precisely that way with all of God's children, irrespective of what you think they may have done, because that's what Jesus did for you. And that's what Jesus offers to them. And that, by extension, is what we offer to them too. Love and forgiveness. The mutual requisites of a Christian life. Amen. Let us pray. Gracious Lord, we give you thanks this day that we have come to a place where we can find love and compassion and forgiveness despite what it is that we have done in life. We thank you for the grace that you've shown us, for the love that you've shown us in the life, death, and resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ. And help us to know that that same love and forgiveness and compassion has been offered to all of your children. And help us to know that we should therefore never, ever stand in judgment of one of your children. For they too have been redeemed by your blood. Help us to reach out to them in love, to reach out to them in compassion and forgiveness, so that through us, your work might be made complete in them. They might know your love and turn themselves around. Let us not be a burden, but rather a blessing to all your children.